Thank you. The next item of business is an urgent question, and I call Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government for its response to the Scottish Law Commission's discussion paper on the mental element in homicide and the wider implications it has in ending the so-called rough sex defence.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
Can I thank Jamie Green for his question and also for the constructive discussion we had once he'd been appointed to his post, and also welcome him to the role of Justice Spokesperson for the Scottish Conservatives. We are very pleased that the Scottish Law Commission has published an extensive discussion paper on reforms to homicide law. The Scottish Government asked the Scottish Law Commission to undertake this project in light of various court judgments which recommended a fundamental study into homicide law, and so it's positive to see that this progress has been made by the Commission. In line with the normal processes for Law Commission reports, we await the Commission's final report, which will be developed and informed by the responses to their initial discussion paper. I don't want, obviously, to preempt the final recommendations of the Commission, but I do very much welcome their inclusion of certain aspects of homicide law for consideration for reform. This includes the Commission looking at whether Scots law needs to be made clearer in terms of the rough sex defence, so-called, whether new defences in respect of those who experience domestic abuse are needed, and the consideration of reforming the defence of provocation in this area of law. It's of course right that Parliament will have the opportunity to consider the Commission's final recommendations on these matters when they report.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response and welcome him to his new role in the challenging of times. But this much-needed discussion paper effectively opens the door for the potential of changes to the law in the most serious of crimes, namely of murder and culpable homicide. The Chair of the Scottish Law Commission, Lady Paton, said that she hopes that this paper will ascertain if current Scots law is truly fit for purpose in the modern era. This is a modern era which has shone a spotlight on violence against women, on coercive behaviour, and redefining how a case for defence is made by those who have suffered at the hands of abuse. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, given that his predecessor, sitting a few feet away from him, previously said that it was only a perception that the defence of rough sex still exists in Scots law, if responses to the paper make it clear that it is the law itself which is deficient, not perceptions of it, will the Government commit to legislative change in this area?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Jamie Green for his supplementary question? I think that is the purpose of this report, so that we can look at what comes back from the Scottish Law Commission, not just in its interim report, but in its final report, when it's had submissions and consultation responses, including indeed from anybody in this Parliament which wants to respond. I think there is an acknowledgement that there needs to be, and that's the purpose of the report, an updating of some of the defences for homicide and murder. There's no doubt about that. And to take into account some of the points that Jamie Green makes about gender-based violence, some of the language, some of the notions that are used. So I understand and accept that point. There is some confusion over the rough sex defence, whether it is actually a defence in terms of a crime that's been committed, or whether it can be used not in mitigation, but certainly to reduce the charge which is made by making sure that the murder charge is not made out, if you like. And also it can be used subsequent to a finding, a guilty finding, in order to inform sentencing. And I think it's very important that we have clarity on that, which is one of the things which this report seeks to do. And I would hope that would be welcomed, not just by Jamie Green, but by everybody else that's interested.
Jamie Green.
I do agree with the Cabinet Secretary in the sense that there can never be any defence for gender-based sexual violence. That's something this chamber would commit to agreeing on. But the SNP manifesto ahead of the election did promise, and indeed committed to, a reformed justice system. The problem is, Presiding Officer, that we have an enormous backlog in our courts right now. There are nearly 38,000 cases, and the forecast currently is that we won't clear that for at least 4 years. The effects and the trauma of these lengthy waiting times are clear to the victims and to their families. So let me ask, what urgent action has been taken by the Government right now to clear this backlog? And will this reformed justice system finally put the needs and the rights of victims at the heart of it?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Jamie Green will know a number of the actions already taken, both by my predecessor and the Scottish Government previously. For example, the £50 million to help deal with that backlog, the unusual sighting of additional cases that have been taken through the system just now. He is right to say, of course, there's a backlog, a significant one. There is one, I think, in every developed country in the world in terms of backlog, in terms of the courts. However, going back to the point he first raised about this particular report, it is important, and he's right to say there's a need for reform here, that it's taken together. That's why the Scottish Law Commission have taken a number of different aspects of the justice system and put those together, because if you uproot one part of it, you can cause unintended consequences elsewhere. So I think it's very important that they've done this comprehensive review, that it's now subject to consultation, and everybody who is interested has the chance now to make their views heard. And of course, we of course want to do that in a way that when we can make progress, as we are doing with the backlog, we can do that in as fair a way as possible, and taking into account the much better appreciation there is these days for the gender violence within the justice system for women and girls.
Thank you. I have a number of supplementaries. Can I ask members who are interested in asking a supplementary to please press the request to speak button? And can I call Pauline McNeill to be followed by Emma Roddick?
Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that consent to sex can never be a defence to murder or serious sexual assault? The We Can't Consent campaign noted that there were 60 cases across the UK where the so-called rough sex defence was used, and that 40% of women under 40 reported being violently assaulted during sex. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that it is in fact time to remove the partial defence of provocation by sexual infidelity from our law books, to show that when it comes to the law, our law seeks to keep women safe?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would, in general principles, agree with what Pauline McNeill says. There are different things which she's mentioned there. She's mentioned consent, and she's also mentioned provocation, which can be applied in different ways. But I think you're absolutely right to say that consent cannot be used to, if you're harming somebody in that way. Somebody's consent, the old principle, I think it was called the volante, that you volunteer to have that harm done to yourself, is no defence. And I think we have to make sure that the reforms that we carry out to the legal process reflect that. Yes, there's no question it has been used by some people in the past. I think the courts have exercised very keen fairness, if you like, and decision-making powers in relation to whether they see that as acceptable. But I do expect and I hope that the thrust of this report, not just in this one area that we're discussing just now, but throughout it, will lead to an updating in very many important respects of the legal process in this area, and I hope that will be supported by the Labour Party as well.
I call Emma Roddick.
The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that a person who kills in a jealous rage brought on by the belief that they have been cheated on can escape a murder conviction under the law as it stands. Does the Cabinet Secretary believe that, regardless of the ultimate conclusions on the more technical aspects contained within the discussion paper, the partial defence of provocation by sexual infidelity has no place within modern Scots criminal law?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Emma Roddick for her question? I'm not sure if this is the first time she's spoken in the Chamber, but can I welcome her to her place as well in the Chamber? And point out, of course, that some of the points that she raised are similar to the ones that Pauline McNeill has just raised. It's a very important issue. I do hope, though, that members will understand that the Law Commission will prepare this final report with recommendations and deliver that to ministers. And I don't want to preempt that consideration when the final report is provided. But I do, however, think there is a compelling case for serious consideration to be given in this specific area of reform. And I look forward to seeing what people have to say in response to the discussion paper. I think that it's very likely that many people will hold the views expressed by Emma Roddick before the Commission make their recommendations for reform.
And I call Russell Finlay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The so-called rough sex defence isn't the only issue in our justice system to impact women who have been the victims of sexual violence. I'm of course talking about the not proven verdict, which was returned in 20% of all acquittal verdicts in Scotland in 2019-20. But in rape and attempted rape cases, the figure was 44%. Behind these numbers are real people who suffer additional trauma from a verdict which serves no useful purpose. For the sake of future victims, surely not proven must be scrapped without any further delay.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm not sure that was a question rather than a statement, but I would say that, of course, the SNP's manifesto committed to look at this area. I think it's also true that it's linked fundamentally with other potential reforms of the justice system, some of which I think it may well be that the member would support. So I think it's important it's taken forward in a considered way. It's right that time is taken to get these things right. I understand entirely and don't disagree with the points that the member makes about the way this has badly served women in particular in relation to this, but I do think it's important we take it forward in a considered way. considered way. And to that end, I would repeat my invitation to any members, whether it's a justice spokesperson for the Scottish Conservatives, the member himself, or any others that want to contribute to this process. We're more than willing to listen to the points that are made.
Thank you. I call Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. For me, I want to be clear and help protect anyone against any sexual violence. But just to be clear, Cabinet Secretary, in Scots law, there is no so-called rough sex defence. The doctrine of Valenti was excluded by the celebrated case Smart versus HMA in 1975. The Square Go case, meaning that in Scotland, the claim to claim any victim consented to the act resulting in their injury or death is not a defence in itself to crimes of assault to injury, culpable homicide or murder. So does the Cabinet Secretary therefore agree with me that while there is still more to be done to protect against sexual violence, our law in Scotland does not allow for the so-called rough sex defence?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Emma Harper for her question? It is the first time I've heard reference to the Square Go defence in terms of law, but it's a very important point, and it's similar again to the one that both Pauline McNeill and Emma Roddick have raised. An accused person cannot claim that a person consented to the harm caused to them, and so it's right to say there is no, if you like, rough sex, legitimate rough sex defence. However, it's also true to say an accused person may seek to portray events in such a way to reduce the charge, as I mentioned, from murder to culpable homicide. That's for the court to determine in a given case, and I am pleased again that the Commission is looking at this area to see if steps are needed to make the law clearer in this regard, and I will consider carefully the recommendations. But I do agree with Emma Harper that it's important to be clear what is being talked about when discussing the rough sex defence.
And Claire Baker.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I have previously asked the Scottish Government about the recording of data in cases which involve violence during what began as consensual sexual activity. The then Justice Secretary confirmed that the police and the court do not provide information on such cases, but said that discussions would take place with stakeholders about how this data could be extracted. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide any update on related discussions and on any work that is going to be taking place to ensure that data in such cases is recorded so that we can better understand the extent of the issue?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm more than happy to provide that update to the member in writing, but I would say, given the discussion that we've just had and the reforms which are being proposed and the Law Commission's report, this area is going to be subject to substantially more scrutiny, and I think the fact that it should be based on relevant and up-to-date data is very important. So I'm more than happy to respond to where we are just now and also to give some indication of where we intend to go to in future with the collection of such data.
And finally, James Dornan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've long campaigned for the elimination of violence against women and girls, and the Cabinet Secretary will be aware of the campaigns led by my incredibly brave, determined and focused constituent, Fiona Druitt. It's clearly vitally important that we do, and are seen to do all we can to ensure justice is done for all victims of domestic abuse. But can the Cabinet Secretary advise whether the Scottish Government will commit to undertaking research in the future and whether the changes made in England have had any effect in practice?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank James Dornan for his question, and also with him commend Fiona Druitt and the Emily Test, the works that are tirelessly taken to support effective gender-based violence interventions in colleges and universities. And I would commend his constituent Fiona on all her efforts, in particular those which are focused on improving students' wellbeing and ensuring that victims of abuse do not blame themselves for crimes committed against them. I'm aware of the work that she has done in further and higher education institutions. In respect, though, of the changes in law in England and Wales, whereby the previous common law was placed on statute, the effect is now a matter of statute that a person can't claim a so-called rough sex defence, whereas previously it was a common law practice. As the UK Government, though, has acknowledged, this was not a new law, but, as I've said, something that was made clear in statute for the first time. And for that reason, the new statute law is not yet in force. It was only recently passed. But I do commit to answer the member's question directly to engaging with the UK Government to understand what plans they might have to monitor and evaluate the effect of the new law.
Thank you. That concludes that item of business. And the next item of business is consideration of business motion 00196 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a revised business programme for this week. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and moved.
No member has asked to speak on the motion. The question is that the motion be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed, and there are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that Amendment 144.4 in the name of Annie Wells, which seeks to amend Motion 144 in the name of Humza Yousaf on health recovery, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote, and we will suspend for a technical break.